What's up, guys? Today's junk is going to be a breakdown in tools, parts, and cost for everything to rebuild the 8.8 out of my 92 F-150. If you're watching this video, you're probably fully aware that the 8.8 rear end has been used in a variety of vehicles. Mustangs, trucks, Broncos, you get the idea. And they're pretty easily found, and they're pretty easily rebuilt as far as I'm concerned, but this is the first time I've ever tried to do this. So while watching this video, if you see anything that seems out of place, or I say something incorrectly, or you think of something that I didn't consider, please leave a comment down below. Also, I'm gonna have as many links as possible to everything that I'm gonna show you down below in the description so you can follow along, and if you're gonna do what I'm doing, maybe get some of the same parts. So I'm gonna take it to the bench and I'm gonna walk you through everything that I've had to purchase that I've been collecting and acquiring for the past about a month or so. All right, so let's go to the bench. I'm pretty sure I have everything I need except for two major components that I'll describe at the end. I do have a couple extra things that you may or may not need in your consideration of your rebuild, but this is what I'm doing. So we're going to start over here on the bench from left to right. Okay, I got, again, part numbers and things like that will all be down in the description below. I got a bearing rebuild kit from Yukon for the 8.8. It's 09 down. Straight axle master overhaul kit. It's supposed to have all the bearings and things like that that you need, as well as a gasket for the cover and extra shims for the differential and all that. Speaking of shims, I got an extra shim kit. Carrier super shims. This says it's for the GM 12 bolt, and I'm pretty sure this can be used on the 8.8 as well, and that's why I picked it up. It's a variety of shim sizes of various thicknesses that can be used to help get your backlash and all that stuff figured out. I also got a set of bearings and seals for the axles at the end of the axle tubes. And this is also from Yukon. I got an extra pinion bearing that I'm going to use for a setup bearing and trying to figure out the setup of everything as I put it in. So this is a tip that I got from watching other videos on YouTube of how to do something like this. And many of them recommended getting an extra bearing that you can hollow out the inside, because normally this has to be pressed on the pinion. And once it's on there, you don't want to go taking it off. So use a hollowed out version that just slips on and off. That will allow you to figure all the details out. And then you put the actual bearing on that should be included in that first Yukon kit that I mentioned. Then I got two new axles. These are both from Yukon. Driver side and passenger side. I got the part numbers here. I'll put them up on the description. So let's move the camera over a little bit past the axles so we can get a better look at what we got left. All right, next, of course, I had to get some new wheel studs. There's no sense in me pulling out the old wheel studs from the old axles. I just got new ones, and this is a kit that I got from Dorman, right on Amazon, no big deal. If I'm installing them, I'm gonna need a wheel stud installer tool. And this helps save the axles from getting any gouges or anything in the outer flange here. If you're just gonna use like washers or something like that. This is supposed to help speed things up and is the right way to do it, so we'll see. All right, now we're on to specifically tools, and you know, you might have some of these, you might not. I had some of these, others I didn't. So the first thing I had to buy is a rear axle bearing puller kit. And this is a axle puller that slips into the axle, and then you put this on the slide hammer and you pull out the axle bearing. And this is going to be pretty helpful because I tried to do the bearings without it. It's just not a right way to go. This is going to be much better. And I got this right from Harbor Freight. There's a variety of versions of these identical kits on Amazon. I'll put a link for one of those. Now this is something I had for quite a long time already for other jobs and projects. This is a bearing and seal installer kit. Also from Harbor Freight. I'll put a link for something similar in Amazon down below. And this is a variety of sizes to install bearings evenly and straight without getting them all kind of cockeyed and ruining your bearing and races. Comes with this little handle here, okay? You take that screw out, you put it through the hole in one of these guys, and then you use a hammer to pound it in straight. You keep going, going, and going until the sound changes. When the sound changes, you know you've seated the bearing and or race. All right, next, let's get these guys out of the way. This tool is more for the teardown of the 8.8. I didn't have a bearing separator kit. So I had to get this from Amazon. Harbor Freight has something pretty much identical. I'll put a link for this one. And then you need a press, a shop press, to use something like this. So I picked up Harbor Freight's 20-ton shop press. And I have yet to use the press. I have yet to use the bearing puller set and the bearing splitter set to finish off the teardown of the axle itself. So I have just a few minor things I need to do before I can start rebuilding the thing. Now, this is where my understanding kind of reaches its confidence limit, okay? There's some things here that I've never done, I've never used. I'm totally confident with these bearing pullers and stuff like that and shop press and all that. What I'm a little unsure about is setting things like the backlash and the pinion depth. So I got two tools. Now, again, my understanding is like right at the upper limit here. I got from Jegs a reasonably priced pinion depth setting tool. I don't know, we'll see what happens. But this is, it comes with a dial, okay, and all kinds of different things like this. This is supposed to bolt into one of the bearing cap fastener holes and hold itself in place, and then you can use the dial to determine the pinion depth properly and get that set up the way it should be so you don't have any problems down the line. This is the most affordable kit that I could find with reasonable reviews. And I got this right from Amazon. You can get it from the Jegs website as well. But I have confidence that this will get me where I need to be. I also got this dial indicator set to check the backlash. Now, this has a magnetic base. So similar dial indicator to set the backlash. But this comes with a variety of tips that you can use in various situations, and it's possible. And again, my understanding is at the upper limit here. It's possible I only needed one of these tools, one dial indicator, because it looks like, and I'm just spitballing here, that the dial indicators from either one could fit either tool. So I may have wasted my money on one of them. I still have a lot of research to go and do. So that's, again, don't quote me exactly on that, but I'll put a link to both of these down below. Next, and one of the last things, is a yoke, a pinion yoke wrench. This is going to be used to finally put that nut on the pinion to help hold everything in place. That's one of the last steps, okay? And this has provisions for, it looks like ratchets, okay, where you can hold it in place and then put a wrench or a ratchet and socket on the nut itself. So this will keep it in place and then you can tighten a nut. As far as I know, this is one of the most appropriate ways to do it. We'll see. It's an adventure. All right, next, I'm gonna move the camera around, get some stuff off the bench because I gotta show you something a little different that something I just wanna put on the axle to make it a little stronger. The 8.8 axle is very common, but it does have its shortcomings. Namely, the axle tubes are just pressed into the differential, and then there's a couple of plug welds on the outside to help it from spinning. So this spinning action of just being pressed in is one of its major downfalls and drawbacks. So one solution around that, it's something I'm gonna do, is weld the axle tubes around the housing. Go all the way around the circumference to keep it from spinning like so. And that will keep it and make it a stronger rear end and axle for the truck. I'm also gonna add an axle truss. I got this from Amazon. It's made by Barnes, four-wheel drive or 4x4, something like that. link down below. And this is a pre-cut, prefabbed axle truss that I just have to install and weld up myself. This was like $135 for that price of it being professionally CNC'd and bare metal, ready to be installed, I think was a good price, at least for somebody like me. I don't have the CNC and I don't have the ability to make something this nice with this degree of precision. It also has the remaining hardware that's needed to get it installed properly. So this, along with welding the tubes in place, will make this axle as strong as possible. There are two items that I don't have currently in my possession that I'm either waiting on or I'm waiting for the funds to order. So the first thing up is actually the gearing, the ring and pinion gearing that's gonna go within the differential itself. And I'm switching from, originally it was stock, it was a 355 limited slip. I'm going to a 456. The reason why I'm going to a 456 all the way from a 355 is that I want to increase the tire size. And according to my calculations, it seems like the most reasonable way to have the best gearing, fuel economy, with low end grunt and torque and all that stuff that I need in this truck. So 456 seems like the best way to go. I want to do 35 inch tires with a slight lift and all that stuff. And it just seems like I said the best way to go. Finally, I want to get a locker. And I'm leaning towards the aux locker. I want to do the electric selectable aux locker. So I can just hit a switch, locker turns on and off. And from my understanding, when the locker is disabled, it acts as a limited slip differential anyway. So I have limited slip, and I would have a selectable locker with that type of system. That's the most expensive part of this whole deal. And again, there'll be links and prices and everything down below in the description. Please check them out. And if you have any comments, suggestions, things that I may have forgotten, whatever, please leave the comment down below.
So here we are in the office, and I just added everything up during the editing process of this video, and I came to a grand total. Keep in mind that there is a selectable locker included in this for $1,300. It comes to $2,680, so about $2,700, give or take, to rebuild and strengthen the 8.8 in the way that I'm doing for this 92 F-150. There are some options that you may or may not want to consider. There are probably other options that I didn't even think of that you might want to add to this. But the bulk of this price, literally almost half of the price that I just gave you, $2,700, is the $1,300 aux locker. And that's, in my mind, worth the total price because it's going to extend the capabilities and make this an even better axle. Having said that, $2,700 is a significant amount of money. And if you were just doing a budget rebuild, you can go way, way cheaper and find more inexpensive ways to do this. This is more of a performance-minded rebuild. And one thing that I did not include in the price is a disc brake conversion kit that I would like to add to this as well. And I'm budgeting around another $7 for that. Hopefully I can get it cheaper. Maybe I can hobble together a kit, or I can find an affordable kit that comes all in one and I can just install it on the axle ends. I'm budgeting $700 for that. So that puts me about $3,400 into the rear differential axle alone. In doing my internet research and looking up 8.8 performance build, just a total package, ship to the house and get it dropped off and then I can install it. Does not have the same locker. An aux locker I could not find as an option in any of these performance builds. So that was around $2,500 in that ballpark, $2,000 to $3,000 for a kit professionally built and sent my way with shipping and tax and all that stuff. So let's call it 25. So for 27, I'm getting all that plus an aux locker. I don't see this as a lose. So we won financially with this build, and now it's on to getting it done. So now that I gave you the grand total, $2,700 plus another $7-ish for the rear disc brake conversion, let's head back to the garage.
So that's pretty much that. I'm an inexperienced, I have zero experience doing something like this, but I've been doing a lot of research. And from what I understand, I'm probably like 95% there with everything I need to get this 8.8 rebuilt and almost ready to be underneath the truck again. So my next step is to get those axle bearings out using the axle bearing puller that I mentioned earlier, and use the Harbor Freight press to get the shim off of the old pinion. Here's the old pinion here. There's a shim underneath this bearing, and this is the bearing I was talking about earlier. The bearing that's on here now, it's got to be removed, get that shim out, and then I can use the extra bearing that I purchased as a setup bearing on the new pinion. You get the idea. And this is the nut on the pinion that I was talking about with this yoke tool. So this will keep this thing from spinning while you install that nut up top. So there's a lot of literally moving pieces to this whole project, and it's definitely a learning experience. I'm doing the best I can, and I'm trying not to make any terrible decisions, and I'm hoping you guys can keep me in line with that as I learn my way through doing something like this. Biggest project I've ever attempted. So we'll see. All right, if you guys like this video, please click like, comment, share, and subscribe. As always, I can be found on Twitter and Instagram at Getting Junk Done. I have an edited video every Thursday about 10:30 a.m., which is what you're watching now. And I do a live stream every Sunday night, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thanks for watching.